Now, tonight we're going to talk about what's going on and why a holy God does what he does in both time and space and eternity. I want to open up. I'm going to read Jeremiah 2, 5 through 13. Then I'm going to turn it over immediately to David. But as we're talking about wolves, before I went on the show earlier in the day, John Stokes, my beloved friend who used to have me on his radio program all the time, said, "Steve, I've got a full-scale male wolf." He lives up in northern Montana, and he had a wolf on his porch. And I thought, how amazing that God would even use an illustration natural. Ladies and gentlemen, the wolves are on the porch. And by the way, he said a big one. And John knows what grizzly bears look like in his backyard, and he certainly knows what big wolves like. But on the deck, that means it's just literally a touch away. But I want to start with Jeremiah 2, 5 through 13, and I'm going to turn it immediately over to Pastor Langford, because he and I and Aaron Brickman had not talked prior to Aaron receiving from the Lord what he received. David has been preaching, and some of you have heard his teaching, but this is such a wonderful picture that God is presenting to give his people hope, victory, courage, and absolute not allowing the events of the days to overtake God's people without having been warned. And God is shoring up the battlements in every man and woman's lives that will listen to what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. I want to start with Jeremiah 2, 5 through 13. "Thus saith the Lord, what iniquity have your fathers found in me, that they are gone far from me, and have walked after vanity, and are become vain? Neither said they, Where is the Lord that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, that led us through the wilderness, through a land of deserts and pits, through a land of drought and the shadow of death, through a land that no man passed through and where no man dwelt? And I brought you into a plentiful country to eat the fruit thereof and the goodness thereof. But when ye entered, ye defiled my land and made mine heritage an abomination. The priests said not, Where is the Lord? And they that handle the law knew me not. The pastors also transgressed against me, and the prophets prophesied by Baal," or Baal, "and walked after the things that do not profit. Wherefore I will yet plead with you, saith the Lord, and with your children's children will I plead. For pass over the isles of Chittim, and see, and send under Kedar, and consider diligently, and see if there be such a thing. Hath the nation changed their gods, which are yet not gods, but my people have changed their glory for that which doth not profit? Be astonished, O heavens, at this, and be horribly afraid. Be very desolate, saith the Lord, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and have hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water." Tonight, Pastor Langford and I will give to you the counsel of God as given to us, and I pray that your ears will be open, your eyes will be open, and you'll have answers to so many of the questions, and I believe that we'll be able to, by the grace of God, give you the puzzle tonight, and there will be no questions in your mind what's going to happen. There's going to be no questions in your mind how the Lord is going to sustain us through what's going to happen, and that all glory will ultimately be given to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is worthy of all praise. Go ahead, David.
Thank you, Steve, and thank you, Joe and Doug, and it's a great joy, as always, to be with you, brethren, and to share the unsearchable riches of Christ. One of the most profound things about the Word of God, it allows us to know where we are. God's Word is literally a road map giving us signs, indicators, showing us events and things even before they come to pass. And that is what's so great about the Word of God. That's what makes the Word of God, beyond any shadow of a doubt, true. Because God gives us the events before they actually take place. And so many people miss that. They miss the fact that God, through the Holy Ghost and the Word, reveals to us these things before they come to pass. And this is so powerful, in that God would be that gracious to let us know that. But I want to begin tonight, first of all, with the book of Exodus and Deuteronomy, Ezra, and then with Daniel. talking about judges. I want people to understand who established our laws in the land in the very beginning. We talk about Judeo-Christian values. Our government was established from biblical principles, and I'll show that to you through the scriptures. I want to go to Exodus chapter 18, verses 19 through 24. Hearken now unto my voice. I will give thee counsel, and God shall be with thee. He's talking to Moses. Be thou for the people to Godward, that thou mayest bring the causes unto God. Thou shalt teach them ordinances and laws, and shalt show them the way wherein they must walk, and the work that they must do. Moreover, thou shalt provide out of all the people able men, such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness, and place such over them to be rulers of thousands, and rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, and rulers of tens. And let them judge the people at all season. And it shall be that every great matter they shall bring unto thee, but every small matter they shall judge, so shall it be easier for thyself. And they shall bear the burden with thee. If thou shalt do this thing, and God command thee so, then thou shalt be able to endure, and all this people shall also go to their place in peace. This was Jethro, or Reuel, Moses' father-in-law, giving him this advice, which was ordained of God. Deuteronomy 1, verse 16, And I charged your judges at that time, saying, Hear the causes between your brethren, and judge righteously between every man and his brother, and the stranger that is with him. Ye shall not respect persons in judgment, but ye shall hear the small, as well as the great. Ye shall not be afraid of the face of man, for the judgment is God's, and the cause that is too hard for you, bring it unto me, and I will. Moses is saying, if it's too hard for you to adjudicate, bring it to me, I will then adjudicate. Deuteronomy 16, verses 18 and 19. Judges and officers shalt thou make thee in all thy gates, which the Lord thy God giveth thee throughout thy tribes, and they shall judge the people with just judgment. Thou shalt not rest, W-R-E-S-T, means to bend away, to overthrow, or to pervert the judgment. Thou shalt not respect persons, neither take a gift, for a gift doth blind the eyes of the wise, and pervert the words of the righteous. That which is altogether just shalt thou follow, that thou mayest live, and inherit the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Deuteronomy 25, verse 1. If there be a controversy between men, and they committed judgment, that the judges may judge them, then they shall justify the righteous and condemn the wicked. Micah 3:11. The heads thereon judge for reward, and the priests, the prophets, teach for hire, and the prophets thereof divine for money. If they will lean upon the Lord and say, Is not the Lord among us? None evil can come upon us. Now there in Micah is he's demonstrating the perversion as it begins. Ezra 7:25. And thou, Ezra, after the wisdom of thy God that is in thine hand, set magistrates and judges, which may judge all the people that are beyond the river, also just know the laws of thy God, and teach ye them that know them not, and whosoever will not do the Lord thy God and the law of his kingdom, that judgment be executed speedily upon him, whether it be unto death, or to banishment, or to confiscation of goods, or to imprisonment. Zephaniah 3:3. Her princes within her are roaring lions, her judges are evening wolves. They gnaw not the bones till the morrow. In other words, they just devastate immediately. And here's the clincher in Daniel's prayerful repentance in Daniel 9:12. Listen to the words of the man of God. And he, talking about God, hath confirmed his words, which he spake against us and against our judges that judged us, by bringing upon us a great evil, for under the whole heaven hath not been done as hath been done upon Jerusalem. Daniel said, "This evil has come against us because our judges that judged us. They judged us unrighteously. They perverted the laws of God. They distorted the truth of God. They opposed what was righteous, and they did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord." And needless to say, that's what we witnessed last Friday in this nation. This nation now lives under tyranny. I want people to understand tonight, the Supreme Court justices did not adjudicate any kind of law whatsoever. They interpreted and redefined the 14th Amendment. I'll say this very simply. Obamacare was written through the legislative part of Congress and Senate, bandied back and forth, finally passed, confirmed, sent to the White House, and signed in law by the president. There was nothing of that nature whatsoever relative for the Supreme Court justices to adjudicate relative to law. This is redefining the institution of marriage and giving sodomites, homosexuals who are so perverted and such an abomination, the same rights as heterosexual normal people. We keep hearing the terms transgender, transgenic. That simply means that the chromosomes, the body, the genes have been artificially altered and changed by man. God does not do that. That is the perversion of mankind. Now, I'm going to be a little bit lengthy here, and I'm going to give it back to Steve, but I want to show the witness that Aaron Brickman got almost word for word, and the word the Lord gave me in September of 2012. It was on Saturday morning about 10 o'clock, and the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart, said, "I want to give you the understanding of the closing and waning verses in Proverbs chapter 1. So from about 10 o'clock Saturday morning until 2 a.m. Sunday morning, I spent 16 hours in these verses in prayer and reading and meditation and trying to get the mind of God. And I know Steve has posted that on his website under the alerts section. It's on the internet. All you got to do is Google prophetic warning, Pastor Langford. But I want to share part of it. I won't read the whole thing, but I'm going to read up to the point where we get word for word what the Lord gave Aaron Brickman. I'm going to read the scriptures. Wisdom crieth out, Proverb 1:20. Wisdom crieth without. She uttereth her voice in the streets. She crieth in the chief place of the concourse, in the openings of the gates. In the city she uttereth her words, saying, "How long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity? And the scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge. Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you, because I have called, and ye refused. I have stretched out my hand, and no man regarded. But ye have said it not all my counsel, and would none of my reproof. I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh, when your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you. Then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. For they that hated knowledge, and did not choose the fear of the Lord, they would none of my counsel. They despised all my reproof. Therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way, and be filled with their own devices. The turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely, and shall be quiet from fear of evil." Now here's what the Lord gave me the understanding to that passage of Scripture. Never before has wisdom cried like it is crying today from the streets to the chief places of the concourse. The concourse is a place where the tumultuous and great commotion of an angry mob resides, to the point wherein there is great agitation. The chief places speak of those who are appointed, elected, or specially those who are in high places, those who are appointed, elected, or self-appointed, especially those who are in high places. In the streets and in the gates of the cities, there is a moan, and a crying from wisdom declaring something beyond description is imminent. What is wisdom crying? Listen to the spirit of wisdom as she speaks to the multitudes. Ye simple ones, how long will you love simplicity? The simple ones are the seducible ones, the silly ones. We read in 1 Timothy 4:1, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith and give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. 2 Timothy 3:13, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. The deceived are those who are deluded, easily persuaded, enticed, or allured. They are seduced by the power of fascination, charm, and appeal from Satan's emissaries, and those emissaries are trapping literal untold millions. We read in 2 Corinthians 11:14, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. How long will you love simplicity or the sinister way? The ways of evil with very ominous signs are appearing everywhere in this nation. The Romans had a belief that unfavorable omens appear on one's left side. Today we hear the phraseology all the time. They are too far to the left. The root word is sinstral, meaning the left side. An ill-omened disaster is about to unfold upon this nation. Thus the psalmist declared in Psalm 16, verse 8, I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Hebrews 8 and 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. Simply put, you'd better be on the right side. Wisdom says to the agitated mob, how long will you scorners delight in scorning? Or how long shall the mockers deride in their mocking? Isaiah 28, 22. Now therefore, be ye not mockers, lest your hands be made strong. For I have heard from the Lord of hosts a consumption, a final end. That's what the word consumption there means. A final end, even determined upon the whole earth. In the New Testament, we read in Galatians 6 and 7, be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Wisdom declares that fools possess a hatred for knowledge. The word hate here in the Hebrew means to hate violently, to be untrustworthy. It also means to show a negative preference. Did we not witness at the Democratic National Convention a negative preference toward God and his city, Jerusalem? How openly they booed God in Jerusalem right before the nation without any reservation whatsoever. Remember, love unites, but hate divides. We have a solemn warning found in 1 Timothy 5 and 22. Neither be partaker of other men's sins. Keep thyself pure. Needless to say, today the church has become totally unequally yoked with unbelievers. We're warned in 2 Corinthians 6:14, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Again, we read in 2 Corinthians 6:17, wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. It is a certainty that no man can serve two masters. Wisdom says that they hate knowledge. Romans 1:28 says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. The knowledge of God also allows one to refrain from error. God says, if you loathe my knowledge, then you will go into captivity. Isaiah 5 and 13, therefore my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge, And their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst. Wisdom says, turn at my reproof. In other words, turn at my pleading, at my chastisement, and turn to me because of my righteous arguments. If you will turn, I will pour out of my spirit upon you, the spirit of revelation, the spirit of knowledge, and the spirit of understanding. If you will turn, I will make known my words and my will for your life, saith the Lord. I have called and preached as well as summoned you into my holy court, the court of my holy word. God said, my court is holy. In my court there is justice. Be assured that my call is a specific call and not some mere random call. It is a call to get your attention so that spiritual contact can be initiated by my spirit. As I called Adam, I said, Adam, where art thou? Today I call out to you, where are you? But you have refused, and you are unwilling. I have stretched out my hands. Now, listen to this. I have stretched out my hands, my nail-pierced hands. My hands are a symbol of power, of assistance, hands of deliverance. Now that you have refused my hands of mercy and my hands of grace, and have no regard for my hands will now become like an angry man shaking his hands in your face. My hands will now cause you to quiver. You will vibrate up and down, and my hands will be like a sickle in the earth, saith the Lord. Now I want to quote what Aaron Brickman said Monday night. The Supreme Court will render its verdict, and it will roar over the nation. I could feel the force, almost like a vibration that would cause one to tremble to go through me. That's exactly what the Lord said to me. My hands will now cause you to quiver. You will vibrate up and down, and my hands will be like a sickle in the earth, saith the Lord. You have said it not all my counsel, and you have ignored all my words and my messages, just like in the days of Moses. My people of Israel had gotten out of hand and began running wild, so has your nation. Israel having their drunken orgies and hath forgotten my hand of deliverance, so have you forgotten me today. Wisdom now says, I will laugh at your calamity, your destruction, your ruin, and your disaster. There will be great oppression, and I will stir many fires among you. In the last 8 days, there have been 7 churches alone set on fire here in the southeast. Wisdom says, I will mock your fear when it comes, when your terror, your dread, and panic arises. I will mock you as someone who is stammering. Your fear will come as desolation, like a crash, a rushing, devastating storm. So shall the tempest be around you. You have sown to the wind, and you shall reap the whirlwind. Anguish shall come upon you, and you will be constrained as in a straight and narrow place. It will be a place of distress and of great need, a place of difficulty, says the Lord. Wisdom says, many shall call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they will not find me. Have I not said that my spirit shall not always strive with man? Have I not said, seek me while I may be found, and call upon me while I am near? Many of you have mocked my messengers and despised my words and misused my prophets until my wrath has risen up against you and there is no remedy. Repentance, 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 repent now. You've hated my knowledge and you chose not to fear the Lord God of heaven and of earth. You did not choose to fear me, saith the Lord. Did I not declare that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction? You would none of my counsel. You despised my reproof. You once received my favorable attention, but you have rebelled and will now see and witness my unfavorable side and my disdain. For many who could have received me have chosen to reject me. Those that reject me will now eat the fruit of their own ways and of their own doing. You will now be filled with your own devices and counsel, and that will be all that you will know. Your advice and resolve is far too little in measure to deliver you, saith the Lord. For the turning away of the seducible and the seduced one shall slay them. Homicide, murder, and killings will now fill your land. Just as Cain murdered Abel, so shall it be in your land. The prosperity of the seduced shall destroy them. Your security and peace is a false peace and security, saith the Lord. Your days of tranquility, security, and of success are now terminated. Abaddon, Apollyon, the king of evil, mongrel, and hybrid spirits will soon be released to bring their destruction upon the whole earth, and they will be the downfall of many nations. The withering of your crops, your fading strength, hope, wisdom, knowledge, and wealth will perish, saith the Lord. But those of you who have hearkened unto me shall dwell and reside permanently. For you shall be made to lie down in green pastures. It is I who give stability. For heaven and earth shall be moved, says the Lord. For I say to my people, fear no evil, for I am with you. I am your refuge and your comfort. I am your security and your success. For the works of your righteousness shall be your peace. The effect of righteousness will be quietness and assurance forever. My people shall dwell in a perfect habitation, in a sure dwelling, and in a quiet place. My son Jesus is your tabernacle. He is your refuge and strength when the day of trouble is manifested. Fear not, for I am with my people, saith the Lord, and I will fight, and like a mighty army I will fight for you, saith the Lord. What I found so profound about that was, he says, Abram said, I could feel the force like a vibration that would cause one to tremble to go through me. And the Lord gave me that same phrase, my hands will now cause you to quiver, you will vibrate up and down, and my hands will be like a sickle in the earth. God is so merciful, God is so long-suffering to warn us. And just like the scriptures that Steve has already shared with us, the people continue to go the opposite way of the Lord Jesus Christ. And regretfully, there's going to be a grave price that's going to be paid. And these judges that have done this, have brought this on us. Daniel said, the judges that judged us have brought this on us. And regretfully, these officials are appointed and they are in high places. And this is the rulers of the darkness of this world in high places. And they're bringing this judgment on us. And, of course, the parades, the rainbows on the White House, all of the sordidness is such contempt toward God. And God, regretfully, is going to smite this nation. Now, it may be before the fall of the year. God can do anything he wants to do, but it's evident to me we're in some type of seven-year cycle, and if it's not this fall, it'll be before the fall. But there's a pattern that's been established, and God is a God of pattern. He showed Moses the pattern of the tabernacle in heaven and said, this is what I want you to build, and he gave him the pattern. God lays out the guidelines. That's why he told Moses to get the magistrates, get the judges, and teach them to judge correctly and judge righteously. And do not be bribed or anything of that nature, because gifts blind judgment. And folks, we are in a very, very dangerous, dangerous state and place right now. The whole world is for that part. And if you've ever wondered, you need to finally take it for what it's worth. America is Mystery Babylon. That's the great mystique. America, they say, is mentioned nowhere in the Bible. But I want you to look at the role and the significance that this nation plays in the entire world, but nowhere is America per se mentioned in the Bible as a nation. I believe that's the great mystique, Mystery Babylon. And we are nothing but a whore, and we get in bed with every other government, and we try to dictate and legislate to others, whether it's abortion or giving nations money to control them or whatever the case might be. And we're going to pay a great price in the coming day. Steve, I'm going to give it back to you, sir.
What a powerful, powerful word. And David, I'm going to take everyone to 1 Samuel chapter 8, because we're talking about the judges and we're talking about judgment. And the hardest point that I think is for the people of God to embrace is that God is holy, God is faithful, he sent his word, he exalts his word, he esteems his word above even his name. So 1 Samuel 8, tell me if this doesn't sound like the nation that once was, that we have become. See, all truth is parallel, and I think 1 Samuel 8, it will be apparent to everybody. We have rejected God. And it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel. Now the name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second, Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, and took bribes and perverted judgment. That's just a normal day in Washington, D.C., Pastor.
Yes.
Then
yes.
All the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came unto Samuel, unto Ramah. Now remember, Samuel was a prophet, and people saw the hand of Almighty God on him and through him continually. And he said, and forgive me, then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah. And he said unto, and they said unto him, I'm sorry, behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. Notice that they had been separated from all the nations. What people don't understand is the word chosen means separate and separated unto God. And most people think, well, they're just the chosen generation or the chosen people. That means that they're blessed. They were only as long as they walked in his ways. Now listen to this. This is the prophet of God. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. Immediately we go to the second psalm. And what we're seeing, ladies and gentlemen, throughout the world is we are literally seeing the kings of the earth gathering themselves together to say, unto God's Son and unto the King of Glory, we will not have you or your Son to rule over us. We're talking about kingdoms, and the kingdom of this world has come into judgment. I hope everyone will download what Pastor Langford just read out of that prophecy, or you can go to my website, Steve Quayle Alerts, and I want you to print that out. And I want you, seriously, for the next 3 days to read it. Different times during the day, because you need to get it into your spirit. And before you begin to read it the first time, say, Lord, show me. Open the eyes of my understanding. Open the heart of my understanding. Open my ears. Cause me to be sensitive to what the Spirit of God is saying. When something's born of the Spirit of God, the first inclination will be to basically reject it, or the devil will preoccupy your time, or he'll confuse the message. He'll do everything he can to silence the voice or alter the voice of God. David could say white and people swear. He said gray. I can tell you this, it is white and black. There are no 50 shades of gray. There's only one shade of glory. That's a quote. And the Lord said unto Samuel, back to verse 7, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. Notice instantly, ladies and gentlemen, there is a divorce there. There's a great divorce. The God of heaven, who had set his hand upon a special people, special meaning set apart unto him, taken from their pagan ways to reveal himself, said, we don't want to be unique. We want to be like everybody else. That's why the scripture says friendship with this world is enmity with God. That means friendship with the world will put you at war with God. The Lord is the Lord of hosts. He's the God of the armies of heaven. And this is something that I'm praying, David, even before we went to the show tonight. I know you were praying. I know you were in agreement with Kim all day long and all the praying that you've done. But here's the deal, that the Lord has to open the eyes and ears of his people, because tonight people are going to be left with one conclusion. Not choose ye this day whom ye will follow, but choose ye this night whom ye will follow. Now listen to this, it even gets worse. And Samuel told all the words of the Lord unto the people that asked of him a king. And he said, this will be the manner of king that shall reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots. In other words, you're going to take them and conscript them in the military, and to be his horsemen, and some shall run before his chariots, the footmen. And he will appoint him captains over thousands and captains over fifties, and will set them to ear his ground, and to reap his harvest, and to make his instruments of war and instruments of his chariots. Notice it goes from peace immediately into war. And he will take your daughters to be confectionaries and to be cooks and to be bakers. And he will take your fields, your vineyards, and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. Now you're seeing the king plunder. That's exactly what's happened to the middle class. That's the most profound thing. I mean, I heard every word that Aaron said, and I've read his statement and his outline to me to be able to follow a bunch of times. But, Pastor, it stands out to me. The middle class died because they maintained the middle-of-the-road attitude towards God.
Amen.
I had never heard that before. I had never heard that. Even today, it rings through. And I know this, and I know you know this, Pastor Langford, and Doug and Joe, you certainly know. When a thought will not leave you, God will ultimately keep that thought before you until you get it. When you finally hear it in your heart, then the thought will leave. And obviously, there will be other thoughts. But this is where we're at, and he will take your fields and your vineyards and your olive yards, even the best of them, and give them to his servants. What you're seeing is the plundering of the middle class. And now, ladies and gentlemen, what you're seeing with immigration, see, this is the timeliness of the Word of God. This is the forever fruit of truth. You can take this out of the context of time when it was given and bring it right up to date. And he will take the tenth of your seed and all of your vineyards and give to his officers and to his servants. Verse 15. And he will take your men servants and your maid servants and your goodliest young men and your asses and put them to his work. Well, I can't let that one go. And he will take your men servants and your maid servants, your goodliest young men and your asses and put them to his work. Well, I would suggest that no finer representation of asses being put to work than are what we have seen and perceived in the Republican Party rolling over. For years and years and years, I have shared, Pastor, you and I have been on talk radio for a lot of decades now, a couple decades, and the thing is that people still, Christian people still, people who think they're conservatives still, they still want a political solution. There is no political solution. We are a nation given over to judgment. And that's what I pray tonight the Lord will let people understand. He will take the tenth of your sheep, and ye shall be his servants. And ye shall cry out in that day because of your king, which ye shall which ye shall have chosen you. And the Lord will not hear you in that day. Isn't that what you just got through reading in your prophecy, Pastor?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel. And they said, nay, but we will have a king over us. Samuel speaking for God. The very few pastors who are speaking for God, what's the world saying? Nay, we'll have a king over us. Unfortunately, they're going to get the king, and his name is going to be Abaddon or Apollyon. He's going to be king of hell, and hell is going to have its reign. We rejected the king of glory. We rejected Almighty God. We rejected righteousness. We rejected holiness. We rejected love, compassion, mercy, understanding, and wisdom. And now we've got the darkest entity in the history of the universe, beyond even what I can define as coming on to rule and reign. And that's what we're talking about, the reign of Antichrist, that which takes its place and position instead of Jesus Christ. And here's the deal. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel. Samuel's pleading, David. Tonight you're pleading. Aaron pleaded Monday night. Anybody who lifts up the name of Jesus and is talking about the end times from a biblical perspective is pleading on behalf of God, that we also may be like all the nations and our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles. That's indifference, that's apathy, and basically, I can't say the word, but they basically said, and we don't give a darn. And Samuel heard all the words of the people, and he rehearsed them in the ears of the Lord. Now, remember, God obviously is hearing what the men are saying, and he's seeing their hearts and everything. And the Lord said to Samuel, hearken unto their voice, and make them a king. And Samuel said unto the men of God, go ye every man unto his city. It goes from there, from bad to worse. Obviously, we know the story of Saul, King Saul. We know the battle between the king and the chosen of God, the anointed King David. And as I look, Pastor David, at what's unfolding before us, it's absolutely a repeat of history, only on a much greater wicked scale. Jesus himself said that if the days weren't shortened, there'd be no flesh left alive. And now we've got ravenous wolves. I'm going to turn it right back over to you, Pastor. We've got absolute hatred for the Son of God, and the people of God don't even give a tinker's darn, okay? Now, they'll say, oh, yes, we do. We pray. We do all this. Well, the bottom line is that where were you when Jesus was being mocked? Where were you when he was being scourged in the press by those sevenfold children of hell known as the mainstream media? Where were you when the blood of the innocents was being splayed, S-P-L-A-Y-E-D, that means just spread over everything? Well, you just conceded that. And now that those who supposedly call themselves by the name of the Lord have acquiesced to the greatest breaking of a covenant in the history of our time. It was God who established marriage. And here's what's amazing, David. I don't know if there's 50, 60% evangelicals, but they estimate the entire gay transgendered population at 3%. 3% have now taken over. And those of you who are Christians that voted for the Obama nation of desolation, God is going to hold you responsible. And those of you who voted for George Bush because you were looking for a king other than Jesus, unless ye repent. You know, repentance is the most amazing word. It is literally the highway to heaven. Repentance will automatically lead us into the presence of the king. The fact that God has chosen his terms and chosen his son to be the enforcer of the terms through his blood, the blood of Jesus, is the most astonishing event in all of human history and all prehistory. It is the most singular, focused act of love, mercy, and forgiveness, and there is no way for my tongue to confess the wonder and the beauty of the Lord Jesus Christ. But ravenous wolves, dressed in sheep suits, okay, and sheep suits, but sheep suits, they're, to my knowledge, and I think, David, you and I talked about this, one thing we did talk about, outside of Franklin Graham, I believe Dobson, and a few independent men, I'm not talking now about individual pastors on a scale, but the national manifestation and representation of that which people see as a church have been silent because they don't want the hassle. They don't want anything outside the people to keep giving them money. And in the second hour, David, we're going to get into what's going to happen to the judgment on the false pastors, and we're going to get into the marking of God's people. But go ahead, Pastor.
You know, what I find, Steve and Doug and Joe tonight, is the insensitivity. People are no longer sensitive to the Spirit of God. Now, I know those of us, and for the most part, those listening are grief-stricken by what has taken place, and our spirit is grieved. Ephesians 4:30, Paul said, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed until that day of redemption. Well, what does that mean? Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. That simply means do not make the Holy Ghost sorrowful for the way that you are living. Now, I want you to witness the reprobate apostate president, the imposter president, as he eulogizes the black president. He breaks out in amazing grace. Yet the rainbows are on the White House, what, Saturday night. You cannot serve two masters. And this is what people have done. They've turned this thing into a Burger King religion. You can have it your way. That's apostasy. Jesus was emphatic. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm not a way. I'm the only way. And so what you have seen and what you have witnessed is a convoluted mixture. And God hates a mixture. And that's what we have is a mixture. And when you witness these things, it ought to make you shudder to hear a man laud sodomy and yet have the audacity to sing Amazing Grace. That shows you the spiritual disconnection. That shows you the spiritual disconnection with a godly consciousness. I call it God consciousness. When you are God conscious and you do something wrong, suddenly your conscience is pricked by the Holy Ghost saying, you just lied. You just stole. You just embezzled. You just cursed or whatever the case might be. That's God consciousness. Now, Psalms chapter 10, verse 4. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all of his thoughts. Now, other than those dissenting justices that oppose this, how much was God's word, God's spirit, in their thought process? David said, God is not in all of their thoughts. Miss Ginsburg drinks so much wine till she stooped over, can hardly sit in her chair at the State of the Union address. These are the people that are adjudicating, which, again, as I said, was not even a law. It was adjudicating or changing the definition of marriage. And this is why it's so frightening that you have people who are that skewed mentally. You know, now here's the thing, and I want people to understand this. You can be a moral person and not be a Christian. You can be a moral person and say abortion is wrong, adultery is wrong, lying is wrong, et cetera, et cetera. But a Christian has to have the moral high ground because of their Christianity. They have to look at a circumstance and situation and say, that's wrong. That is evil. Elijah said, how long will you be halt between two opinions? Either God is God or he's not God. And we've turned Christianity into a passiveness. And personally, I am angry. I am angry. You say, well, Pastor, you ought not be angry. Isn't that a sin? No. Psalms 7:11 says God is angry with the wicked every day. Ephesians 4:26, Paul said, be angry and sin not. Mark chapter 3, verse 5 says, and he looked about them with anger. Anger is a passion that says this is wrong, and I'm not going to surrender. I'm not going to capitulate. I'm going to stand my ground. Now, here in Charlotte, North Carolina, Friday, the sodomites, the queers, they all stood up and said, hey, we're not satisfied. This is not the end. This is not all we want. Well, I'm thinking, well, this is what y'all said you always wanted was marriage. No. See, in North Carolina and in other states, they've passed laws that if you have a conscientious objection toward marrying homosexual sodomites, that you can recuse yourself and not have to do it. They said, no, we want that law changed. We're going to make you marry us. Steve, how many times have I told you over the last 2 or 3 years, I'm waiting for the militancy of the sodomites to rise up to the degree that they did in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah when they told Lot, we will do worse to you than to these two men if you do not let us know them. I've told Steve, that's the tipping point. Well, now we're there. They got what they said they wanted. Why did they want marriage? Because the Bible says in Hebrews 13:4, marriage is honorable in all, the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. So they wanted the honor. Well, now they got the honor, but they got it through dishonor and they got it through disgrace. They didn't get it right. But that's not enough. They're now pushing that they're going to make us do things that we object to. And that's why you're going to witness great and grave persecution come on this nation. I read today where there's already magistrates, clerks in court, county courts, houses that are resigning, they're quitting because they're not going to do it. They're going to obey God. And these low-life scumbags that call themselves governors, like my governor, Pat McCrory, he's a piece of trash. I'd look him in the face. I met him 30 years ago when we were both doing radio in Charlotte, North Carolina. He did a talk show. Up-and-coming conservative, a lawyer, attorney, but he's corrupt. He said, now it's the law of the land. You're going to marry these people. You see, this is the militancy. And you see, here's the thing about sin. It don't stop. It perpetually encroaches. It's like cancer. It don't stop. If it gets the liver, it's going for the lungs. If it gets the lungs, it's going for the pancreas. It gets the pancreas, it's going for the kidneys. It don't stop till it kills you. This is what's happening. They're going to keep on until they think they have destroyed us and destroyed God. And once they remove God from everything, then they think they're going to have peace and placidity and everything's hunky-dory. Well, I got news for them. You're not going to destroy God. You're not going to destroy his word. You may do everything in the world and man may give you what you want, but you're not going to change God or God's word. It's never going to change. Jesus said in Matthew 24:35, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. And so what every Christian needs to get ready to do is get ready for persecution, because the persecution is going to come. And guys like myself are going to be hammered that I preach hate. And that they're going to come after me because they say, you're a preacher of hate. No, sir, I'm a preacher of righteousness. I preach truth, and when you preach truth, they hate the truth. But the only thing that Jesus said would set men free is truth. John 8:32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. These people are in bondage, and they want to bring you into bondage, and regretfully, the pastors of this nation have allowed it to come to this point. They have allowed it to come to this stage because they won't say anything. Let's see what Joey Osteen says and Kenneth Copeland and all these other mega churches, you know, what's the little Asian guy, Joseph Prince. See what they say. They won't say a word for fear. Well, my Bible says in 2 Timothy 1:7, God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Christians are going to have to stand up. This is going to unite a faction of people. It's going to unite a faction of people, and others are going to fall by the wayside and turn on us. Professing Christians will turn on us. But there'll be those who have the goods, the true goods of Jesus Christ, are going to bind together like the early church and the early apostles, and going to hang in there together and fight this thing together through the word of God, through the blood of the Lamb, and through the power of the Holy Ghost. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 10:3, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds. This is a stronghold over this nation. It has to be pulled down, you see. So we've got to look to God. We've got to cry out to God. Get a hold of his garment. Get a hold of him. You get a hold of God, God will get a hold of you. He's going to change things. I'm not discouraged. I'm excited because I'm looking for a move of God like the church has never seen before. Will it be ugly? Yes. Will it be awesome? Yes. It's like Mike McQuitty said, the worst and the best at both times. And that's where we're being brought to. Look at the delivering hand of God to get Lot out of Sodom and Gomorrah and the judgment of God. They both came together simultaneously. The judgment of God fell on Egypt, but God delivered his people. You're going to witness a dual, I don't know how to say it, a dual program. It's going to be ugly as hell on one side, and the righteous are going to be in the secret place of the Most High and going to be rejoicing and magnifying the Lord. And that's the way it's going to be. It's always been like that. But because of the lethargy, the apathy, and the complacency, we've come to this place. We knew it was coming, as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be also in the coming of the Son of Man. But Jesus in Luke 17:32 closes by saying, remember Lot's wife. We don't even know the woman's name. We know Eve, Mary, the mother of Jesus. We know Esther. We know Ruth. We know Hannah. We have no idea what Lot's wife's name was, but she's the only woman. Jesus said, you better remember her. Why? Because her heart was there, and she looked back. Thus we are commanded, come out. And it's a spiritual coming out. You can't come out of the world in the sense of location. You come out spiritually. That's why it's called whoredom and harlotry. Come out of her. You know, you're into her. Get out of her. You're committing fornication, spiritual adultery. Get out of it.
Steve, you said that we were going to address wolves in sheep's clothing, false pastors this second hour. I'm going to turn over to you. We can get into that whenever you want.
Thank you. I just want to reiterate one thing that Pastor Langford said. David, I had said to you, I didn't understand. I think I said to Aaron, too, I didn't understand what the Lord meant by the axe to the roots in its fullest extent. You've all seen when you hit something that's harder than, let's say, the sledgehammer, the axe vibrates. When God lays the axe to the roots, I got this while you were talking, David, it's going to cause the whole earth to shake. And then I got it. Yet once more will I shake the heavens and the earth. The Lord is laying his axe, and it's a battle axe, to the roots of all perversion, all deception, and all evil, because we're in a war, and that's what people don't understand. My prayer tonight is that they'll get it. Let me share what the price you had to pay to enter Sodom. They had a community bed, and the elders would come out and sodomize the men to enable them to come in. Now, what does Sodom represent? Well, obviously, in its day, it was known as the pleasure palace of the desert. Every conceivable and imaginable and unimaginable evil, and I don't need to go into that, was offered. In other words, it was the ultimate bait to trap men. They wanted to basically bring them into their world. I'm going to say something, and we get right into Jeremiah 23. The sexual habits of the giants, which were produced by the fallen angels and earth women, where they went after each other. In other words, there was something that they had to continually remind themselves of, that this was a covenant that God had made with humans, meaning a man and a woman, and they were continually mocking that. And the more they mocked that by their sexual proclivities, by the way, the ancient historians, Diodorus and others, talked about this. I'm not making this stuff up. But the fact now, the world is promising pleasure apart from God. They're promising transhumanism, transcendence. They're promising eternal life and eternal perversion, and they link the two. What's fascinating about this is that God's people are watching the days of Noah playing out right before their eyes, because that's what they did in the days of Noah. They did each other. The rainbow, one of the most amazing promises of God, that he wouldn't destroy the earth with water again, but by fire. What have they taken? They've taken a heavenly and a holy thing, and they basically have turned it into a signet or a sign or an emblem of perversion, saying God's covenant no longer stands. We are greater than God. Now, that's what they're saying. Which brings me to the very same point of Jeremiah 23. I'm going to read this. I'm going to comment. I'm going to turn right back over to David. I want to just one more time say this. The axe being laid to the roots is the root of evil now has come up against God's battle axe. God's battle axe, by laying in and the hand of the Lord, the arm of the Lord, we hear in Scripture, do we not, that the hand of the Lord is not shortened? Well, when God lays his battle axe to the root of the matter, the earth will tremble. The earth will shake. And I David, never in my life have I spoke that. And just while you were speaking, that's what the Lord dropped into my spirit. I hope people can understand what the weight of that statement really means. Woe be unto the pastors that destroying scatter the sheep of my pastor, saith the Lord. Every pastor who claims to be a pastor under the Lord Jesus Christ, you're dealing with the sheep of his pasture. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, against the pastors that feed my people, ye have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not visited them. Behold, I will visit upon you the evil of your doing, saith the Lord. We're going to see that play out in the puke pits of America. And I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries whither I have driven them, and will bring them again to their folds, and they shall be fruitful and increase. And I will set up shepherds over them which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking, saith the Lord. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. That's Jesus. In his days, Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name, whereby he shall be called, the Lord our righteousness. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, they shall no more say, the Lord liveth, which brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. But the Lord liveth, which brought up and which led the seed of the house of Israel out of the north country, and from all the countries whither I had driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land. Now, listen to Jeremiah. Jeremiah is prophesying the future in the first 8 verses, but then he's saying, and from now on, listen to this, mine heart within me is broken because of the prophets. All my bones shake. I'm like a drunken man, or like a man whom wine has overcome, because of the Lord and because of the words of his holiness. For the land is full of adulterers. I mean, what's adultery except the common theme of Hollywood? For because of swearing, the land mourneth. The pleasant places of the wilderness are dried up. And the course is evil, their course is evil, and their force is not right. For both the prophet and the priest are profane. Yea, in my house have I found their wickedness, saith the Lord. Now understand, God's not looking beyond his house, he's looking at his house. Wherefore their ways shall be unto them as slippery ways in darkness. They shall be driven on and fall therein, for I will bring evil upon them, even the year of their visitation, saith the Lord. I believe, Pastor, this is going to be the year of those of the visitation to the false shepherds and the false pastors. It's going to begin in 2015, really manifest in 2016. And I have seen folly in the prophets of Samaria. They prophesied in Baal and caused my people Israel to err. I have seen also the prophets of Jerusalem, a horrible thing. They commit adultery and walk in lies. They also strengthen the hand of evildoers, that none doth return from his wickedness. They are all of them unto me as Sodom, and the inhabitants thereof as Gomorrah. Again, ladies and gentlemen, you've got to see this theme. It is absolutely the Lord speaking. Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts concerning the prophets, behold, I will feed them with wormwood and make them drink the water of gall, for from the prophets of Jerusalem is profaneness gone forth into all the land. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, hearken, and by the way, the Lord of hosts is the Lord of the armies of heaven. Hearken not unto the words of the prophets that prophesy unto you. They make you vain. They speak a vision in their own heart, and not out of the mouth of the Lord. They say still unto them that despise me, the Lord has said, ye shall have peace. And they say unto everyone that walketh after the imagination of his own heart, no evil shall come upon you. Gee, that sounds like TBN in certain prophets that basically just make that statement all the time. For who has stood in the counsel of the Lord and hath perceived and heard his word? Who has marked his word and heard it? Now here's the bottom line. Behold, a whirlwind of the Lord has gone forth in fury, even a grievous whirlwind. It shall fall grievously upon the head of the wicked. The anger of the Lord shall not return until he have executed, until he have performed the thoughts of his heart. In the latter days ye shall consider it perfectly. Notice now, at one point in the beginning of Jeremiah's let's say, dissertation, he's talking about Israel. Now he's talking about lands that are in the last days. I have not sent these prophets, yet they ran. I have not spoken to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel and caused my people to hear my words, then they should have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their doings. Real simple, discerning of spirits, everyone. You want to know a true prophet? If they leave out repentance and if they leave out the point of getting God's people back to him, they are speaking visions after their own heart. How long shall this be in the heart of the prophets that prophesy lies? Yea, they are prophets of the deceit of their own heart, which think to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams, which they tell every man to his neighbor, as their fathers have forgotten my name for Baal. The prophet that hath a dream, let him tell a dream, and he that hath my word, let him speak my word faithfully. What is the chaff to the wheat, saith the Lord? Is not my word like a fire, saith the Lord? And here we go. And like a hammer that breaketh a rock in pieces? Therefore, behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that steal my words, every one from his neighbor. Behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that use their tongues and say, he saith. Behold, I am against them that prophesy false dreams, saith the Lord, and do tell them and cause my people to err by their lies and by their lightness. Yet I sent them not, nor commanded them. Therefore, they shall not prophesy this people at all, saith the Lord. And when this people, or the prophet, or the priest, shall ask thee, saying, what is the burden of the Lord? Thou shalt say unto them, what burden? I will even forsake you, saith the Lord. And as for the prophet, the priest, and the people, that shall say, the burden of the Lord, I will even punish that man in his house. This simply just means that everybody is making it about them, claiming it's their burden. And God said, I didn't put this on you. In other words, they're going after the thoughts, the intents, and the designs of their own heart. Pastor, if you would, I want you to address, because I think it's critical, the wolves that have snuck into the pulpits and the idea, as Aaron shared on Monday, that God's going to roar. And this is no small thing, is it, Pastor David? This is God arising to scatter his enemies, and the fury of the Lord is against wickedness. I don't know how to make that clear. I believe it's impossible for you and I to make that clear outside of God anointing, God revealing, and the Holy Spirit quickening his word. Go ahead, David.
Absolutely, Stephen. When you was reading that verse in Jeremiah, said his bones would shake, and I thought about the vibrations, the shakening. This is what God is going to do, and even the righteous. See, the righteous are going to be shaken, but we will remain. That is unrighteous will not be remaining, because it'll be like the chaff which the wind drives away. The wind will be the judgment of God. He said, you've sown to the wind, you're going to reap the whirlwind. In other words, God's wind is always greater than the wind that people perceive. I want to go to Acts chapter 20, because Paul tells us that in the last days, these false shepherds, these false preachers, and false prophets would not spare the flock. And this is so apropos. It is so timely today in the modern church. Every preacher you ever watch or listen to today has one agenda: money. I've never witnessed in all of my life, and I'm 60 years of age, every preacher on television is begging for money. I don't care who they are. And they ride upon the backs of the people. They burden the people to give them money. But I want to go to Acts chapter 20. We'll do a small exegesis here because it's important. But I want to begin at verse 26. Acts 20, verse 26. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned, or I have not concealed, to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore unto yourselves, and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. Therefore, watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Paul is speaking from Ezekiel's perspective here when he said, I take you to record. In other words, you're my witness. You're recording my words today in your mind, in your conscience. You're making a record in your mind mentally this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. Now, Ezekiel 3:17-18, Son of man, I have made thee therefore a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word at my mouth, and give them warning from me. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way, to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thine hand. Paul is simply saying, there will be no blood at all whatsoever on my hands, because I am pure from the blood of all men. I quoted earlier in that prophecy, 1 Timothy 5:22, neither be partaker of other men's sins, keep thyself pure. There's a price that men pay when they declare the whole counsel of God. And Paul said, I have not shunned, I have not concealed, I have not hidden anything from you. I've preached the judgment of God. I've preached the resurrection of God. I've preached the baptism in the Holy Ghost. I've preached holiness. I've preached against fornication. I've preached against adultery. Romans 1, I preached against sodomy. I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Remember, the epistles are different from the gospels because the epistles are written to the churches. Each epistle starts out to the church at Corinth, to the church at Philippi, to the church at Thessalonica, to the church at Rome, the church at Ephesus. It's to the church that God is speaking to. And yet we have these derelict preachers who say, well, God don't talk about homosexuality. Well, sure he does. You just don't want to preach it because you want to be politically correct. But Paul said, I have not concealed any of the counsel of God. Then he says in verse 28, take heed therefore unto yourselves. Every one of us, those are the words of Christ, Luke 21:34. Take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts become overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life, so that they come upon you unawares. Jesus said, quit looking at your neighbor. Quit looking at everybody else. Look at yourself. Take heed to yourselves. Look at your own self. Hebrews 2:1. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. You see, most preachers today don't preach the Bible. They tell stories, they tell jokes, they have, you know, floodlights, spotlights, strobe lights, fog machines, all of the party atmosphere. I'm totally distraught with World Harvest Television. I was on that network one time, and the other night I turned it on, and I told my wife, I said, look at this. Fog machines, explosions, rock music, supposedly Christian music, but it was nothing but rock and roll music. It was an abomination. Lester Summerall would turn over in his grave if he saw on his network what's being aired on his network. But you know what it's about? Money. It always comes back, Steve, and you know this as well as anybody. It always comes back to the money. 1 Timothy 6:10, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some have coveted after they have erred from the faith. That word erred in the Greek means they have been seduced from the faith. Money will seduce you from the true riches of Christ. It's money, 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 the government, money, everything's money. I'm sick of it myself personally. One of our state senators wants to now tax our car insurance policies to raise money for the highways. I mean, they just sit and they think, how can I get more money? And, of course, the preachers, they are nothing but hucksters and charlatans, and that's all they're after. Let me get back to verse 28. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers. Regretfully, 90% of the preachers have not been called by the Holy Ghost. They're self-appointed. They're self-ordained. He said, over the which the Holy Ghost, he does the calling, he does the appointing, and he said, he hath made you overseers. The word overseers there means a bishop or an elder. And what's the overseer, the bishop, the elder? What's their job? What's their job? To feed the church of God. My job is to feed the flock of God. How many times did Peter deny Jesus? Three. How many times did Jesus ask Peter, do you love me? In John 21? Three. How many times did Jesus say to Peter, feed my sheep, feed my sheep, feed my lambs? Three. Three times three equals nine, which means divine completeness. God was trying to drive a point home in Peter's heart. Peter, feed my flock. Paul says, feed the church of God, not the denomination, but the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, which he hath purchased with his own blood. Now, here's the scary thing to me about preachers. Do they realize whose church this is? Do they realize whose church this is, that they shake down, that they hustle, that they abuse? Jesus, Paul says, he purchased this church with his own blood. It wasn't the blood of another bullock or turtle dove or goat or ram. Revelation 1:5, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. He washed us from our sins in his own blood. His blood. His blood was shed. Ephesians 1:7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin, according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes far off are made nigh by the blood of Jesus. It's the blood of Jesus that brings us and reconciles us back to the Father. Even Judas, and Judas, after he sold Christ, he brought the 30 pieces of silver back in Matthew 27, verse 4. He threw the 30 pieces of silver on the floor. He said, I have condemned the innocent blood. This was the purest, most innocent blood ever, because he was conceived through the Holy Ghost. It was earnest blood. Luke 22:44, and being in agony, he prayed the more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling to the ground. I've read some theologians believe that his capillaries dilated in his blood vessels, and they burst. So instead of sweat coming from his pores, blood actually began to run down his brow as he was agonizing. It was earnest blood, being in an agony. He prayed the more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling to the ground. It's cleansing blood. 1 John 1:7, if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with him, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. This blood cleanses us, because he purchased the church with his own blood. Revelation 12:11, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and through the word of their testimony. How many preachers preach the blood of Jesus Christ? Leviticus 17:11, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that make atonement for the soul. Nothing can atone for sin but the blood of Jesus. And Paul says, I'm telling you, he purchased this church with his own blood. There's such emphasis on this. My God, I sense the Holy Ghost here tonight. Because it's the Holy Ghost that feeds you the Word of God when preachers preach the Word of God. It edifies, it builds, it lifts us up. But here's what Paul said. This is why he was weeping. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you. Grievous wolves. The word grievous there means burdensome. Jesus addressed the wolves in Matthew 7:15-16. He said, beware of false prophets, which come to you wearing sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves, and you shall know them by their fruits. These men are rapacious. In other words, they rob, they spoil, they plunder, they have inordinate greed, they are predatory, they have such a voracious appetite. They're never full. And so these grievous wolves, they darken the people's ability to understand the truth because they don't preach the truth. So when someone like us come on and we preach this, people say, well, that's a little far out there. No, it's just the Word of God. It's just the Word of God. And here's the key. Paul said they would not spare the flock. It doesn't matter how young a convert, how old a convert, whatever their spiritual status might be, they will not spare the flock. They are not careful with God's word. They're not careful with God's people. They plunder, they rob, they spoil, they fleece, they pillage, they loot, they ransack. These preachers are oppressive, and they are very demanding, and they're full of psychology. They play these little mind games and these tricks to get money from people. And they put a burden on you, Jesus said, that they wouldn't bear themselves. In Matthew 23:4, he said, for they bind heavy burdens. Here's the word. Grievous to be borne. They lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. Call them and say, can you send me $1,000? Can you help me with my bills? No, our money's already been allocated for this and this and this and this, like a $65 million jet airplane, I suppose, a $3 million mansion, house on the East Coast, house on the West Coast, house here, house there. All they want you to do, I watched Mike Murdoch. Matter of fact, Joe and Doug, is the last time I did a program with us four. And I was wound up, and I couldn't go to sleep. So I come in the living room, and I sat down, and I turned on Christian television. And there was Mike Murdoch. This guy's up in his mid-70s, and he's still hustling, shaking down people. You can get mad for me calling his name, but Paul identified Hymenaeus. He identified Philetus. He identified Alexander the coppersmith. The beloved John identified Diotrephes. The Bible identifies Cain, Korah, Balaam, the Bible names names. Jans and Jamrees. I mean, he's always naming names. He's, well, you can't name names. Well, the Bible names names. Paul withstood Peter to his face in Galatians 2 for being like a Gentile when he's around the Gentiles. When he gets around the Jews, he goes back to acting like a Jew. And the Bible said that Paul said, I withstood him to his face. He said, Peter, I blame you for this dissension in the church. You're causing the problem, pal. He identified him for 30 minutes. It was an infomercial. And all he kept saying was, I want 300 people to partner with me $58 a month. And I watched this. He would speak about 5 minutes, and he would cut away to a black lady, and she'd say, well, since I started partnering with Mike Murdoch, my money's just exploded. And he cut away to a black gentleman. Same thing. When I partnered with Mike Murdoch, my money began to increase. And it would go back to Mike Murdoch, and he'd talk for 3 or 4 minutes. Complete infomercial cycle over and over. Well, when he got done, I looked at my wife. I said, answer me a question, Kim. She said, what? I said, what did he ask us to partner with him for? Orphans? Widows? Preaching the gospel? Buying Bibles and giving them to people in Africa? What did he want us to partner with him for? She said, you know, he never gave any reason, did he? I said, that's exactly right. He's a grievous wolf, not sparing the flock. All he's wanting you to do is just give him money. And it wearies me. Isaiah 7:13, it's a small thing for you to weary man, but will you weary my God also? I've never seen such a time in my life of these grievous wolves. And Paul said, they will enter in among you, and they will not spare the flock. Now, when we are told, and the Lord uses the word spare, it's in a different context. Isaiah 58:1, cry aloud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet. Show my people their transgressions, and the house of Jacob their iniquities. In other words, don't spare the rich. Don't spare the middle class. Don't spare the poor. You tell everybody, repent of your sins. That's how he tells us to use the word spare. But from Paul's perspective, with these grievous wolves, he said they won't spare the flock because they're going to ransack it. They're going to get all they can out of it. Now watch what he says in verse 30. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse or corrupt things. I've never seen such a corruption of what is called the gospel as I witness today. And Paul says, of your own selves. Now he's preaching to the church here. And he's saying there are men and women in this body of believers right here, right now, among yourselves. They're going to arise in this congregation. They're going to arise in this church. And they're going to start speaking things that are ungodly, that are corrupt. And the reason is to draw away disciples after them. What we do here, Joe, Doug, Steve, myself, and others that the Hagmans have on, they're not trying to draw disciples to themselves. They're trying to get you to Jesus. That's what we're trying to do, because we have a fear of God. We all understand. We're going to stand before God for this program tonight. God is keeping a record. We're making a record tonight. Paul even said here in this text, I take you to record this day. This is recorded in the books of heaven. That's the books in Revelation 21 that will be opened. And the books were opened and the book of life. The books of records are going to be opened. And this program tonight is being recorded in heaven. I'm trying to think of the brother's name who had a vision. He could not believe all the scrolls that he was witnessing in all of these compartments. He was in heaven. And he asked God, he said, what is that? He said, these are records. These are records. I keep a record of everything that's been said, that's been done. So at judgment, it'll all be accurate. What do you call him, a stenographer? Is that what you call him, Steve?
Yeah, I mean, it's like a court stenographer. A court stenographer is the one that records the testimony that's given in court.
We
call it a life recording.
Yeah. So this is what's going on. And Paul says, I take you to record. In other words, he's aware that this is a record is being made of this. And so he says, among your own selves. Now, Steve, you know personally brethren that have departed from the faith. I know brothers who have departed from the faith. They rose up among us, and they went their own way, and they spoke perverse things, because they wanted to draw disciples after themselves. And in closing, Paul said, therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. We're here warning tonight. Paul was warning. You have warning lights on your dash of your car. If that warning light comes on, you know there's trouble. That warning light is there for a purpose. That censer is there for a purpose. God has given us his word. God has given us the Holy Spirit. He's given us messengers that warn us. Why? Because he loves us. Let me quote it again, Ezekiel 3:17, Son of man, I have made thee therefore a watchman under the house of Israel. Therefore hear the words at my mouth and give them warning from me. We're not playing patty cake, Baker man tonight. We're warning you. something is imminent. Wisdom says something is imminent coming on this nation, and you better get right. And it's not just going to be in America. Those of you listening around the world, it's coming to your city. It's coming to your country. It's coming to your county. The whole world. Steve, you were talking earlier about the axe. When it's laid to the root, the battle axe, how it causes the vibration. Well, that's exactly what God said he was going to do in Hebrews 12 and 25. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. Now, this was at Mount Sinai when the mountain shook, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not earth only, but also heaven. That's what Jesus meant. There'll be signs in the sun, the moon, the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations. And this word, yet once more, signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire. When you watch these panty-waist, milquetoast preachers preach, do they preach like our God is a consuming fire? No, they don't. You know why? Jeremiah said his word was shut up like fire in my bones, burning in me like fire in my bones. What made him have that fire and that burning in his bones? Spending time in the presence of God. Spending time on his knees. Spending time weeping. Jeremiah 9:1, oh, that my head were waters and mine eyes a fountain of tears, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. Paul said, I've wept with you people for 3 years. I've wept because I know after I leave, grievous wolves, they're coming in, and they're not going to spare the flock. You know, you listeners should be thankful. You should thank God that Joe and Doug are so gracious to allow people like myself and Steve to come on and to share the word of God. There is a famine. There is a famine of a pure word today. You can't hear a pure word. It's all jokes and charlatans and hucksters and they're like magicians, sleight of hand, what they can get by with, how they seduce people. We've got to awaken, because I'm telling you, something is coming, and these men are going to be held accountable. I would not want to be in the shoes of 99% of the preachers in America today. I would not want to be pastoring a megachurch. No, sir. I don't think I could ever pastor a megachurch, because my preaching would not go over to have a mega crowd. But you see, these men are what we call in a popularity contest. They want acceptance. They want you to accept their personage. I'm not trying to get you to accept my personage. I'm trying to get you to accept Jesus. Jesus is what you need. David Langford will die and go, and others will come and go. Paul came and went. Peter came and went. James. But the word of God lives on. But we see how sparse the word of God has become today. I'm talking about the real word. You know, Steve, you had a burden a year or so ago about trying to get people to pick up the mantle. I'm concerned with the time frame, and if I should die before the Lord returns, who's going to pick up the mantle and keep preaching a pure word? Who's going to do it? You know, I was humbled. I had a guy call me from Virginia just a while back and said, I think God's going to use you to replace David Wilkerson. I said, sir, I could never replace David Wilkerson. I couldn't walk in his shoes. I couldn't handle his shoes. What a great, great man of God. But you see, that man's gone. That man's gone. And who's going to fill the void? And little by little, we're going to be left with a scarcity of a pure Bible-anointed message here in this hour if we're not careful. You need to pray for all of us. Every godly man that Joe and Doug has on. You need to pray that God will strengthen the brethren, strengthen the men, that they can continue on and not be impeded, not be encroached upon, to keep telling the truth so people will know the truth here in the end. Steve, I want to give it back to you or Joe and Doug.
Doug, go ahead and take it for a minute because, you know, obviously you're gracious to yield, but again, this has obviously, everything we're teaching has basically, as you listen to Pastor Langford, hey, David, I told Doug, I said, I'm glad when I get to do the show with and Joe, Doug, and David, because I said, this is the only time I get preached to, or in the case of Aaron, where the true word of God. Go ahead, Joe, and then Doug. Go ahead and just share what God is doing in you guys' lives, because you're the reason God's raised you up to allow people like us to come on to reach the people. And, you know, Doug, you know the flack you get. You know the flack, you know, we all get. But the point is that God is doing something amazing. Go ahead, Doug.
Well, thank you, Steve. And you know, as Pastor Langford was talking, boy, we can be nuts. Well, we can be like everyone else. You know, we get tripped up sometimes, and we get huckstered, if that's a verb, or once in a while, you know, somebody slips by and didn't quite realize the you know what was going on. But in the scheme of things, to listen to Pastor Langford tonight, to listen to you, Steve, and to consider the gravity of what we face. You know, I don't want to sound trite, you know, many people say there's a war against Christians and Christianity. And to listen to Pastor Langford and yourself contextualize this war. You know, this is not just any war or any battle. This is an epic battle between good and evil. It's a war that's been taking place, in, at least in our view, since the creation of man, and it's a spiritual war, one that's fought in the heavens as well as on earth, in my view. And you know what? The stakes are so high. It's a battle for our very souls, isn't it?
Amen.
You know, as Joe and I were preparing for tonight's show, we were talking, we cannot regard this war lightly, and every step we take has got to be very, has got to be within God's world, within that realm of God, because our eternal salvation depends on which side of this war that we conspicuously occupy. And if I could just continue just for a second more, a few seconds more, you know, the entire world, it seems to be awash in a war between good and evil. But I believe, and boy, Pastor, you really solidified it. It's a world war, but I believe the front lines of this war are spread across the United States and are really here in the United States. And the battle's taking place within the borders of the U.S., is, I believe, precisely where the final outcome of this war might very well be decided. Not Armageddon, of course, but in terms of the war that we're fighting about in this topic. And it's so extremely important that every Christian takes a very overt, very public, very strong stand in this battle. Because if we remain silent now, and if we don't take a stand for our faith, for our principles, for God, we are complicit in an agenda of evil that's going to consume us and relegate us to God's judgment. So for us to remain silent today, I believe, is to acquiesce to evil, is to surrender to Satan and give up our birthright.
Amen.
And I feel so strongly about this. And you know, so many people, so many Christians right now are choosing to remain silent under the guise of tolerance. And by doing so, to remain silent for the sake of tolerance is to tolerate evil. And that places us in a position where, well, we're just conscientious objectors. Well, there are no such things in this war between good and evil. And as Christians, we can't sit out this war and expect not to be judged for our inaction. And that's really the only thing I wanted to say.
That is so true, Doug, and we can't sit. We have to do and be vocal because they are. And if we turn into a bunch of pacifists, you know, Abraham Lincoln said, preach the Constitution from the pulpits. Mm. That's what Abraham Lincoln said. And I talked with Rick Weil this morning. And to show you how the persecution is coming, a grand jury in Baltimore, Maryland, has subpoenaed his radio programs during that ordeal.
Oh.
They're coming after us.
Yes, they are.
And they're going to try to stop us because we are the salt and the light. And if they can do away with the salt, put out the light, then they're going to say, we've got it made. But that's nonsense. That's what they thought in Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, they refuse to believe in God. But this is the kind of things that are coming down the pike. Go ahead, Doug.
Well, I just want to, you know, you're exactly right, and I sought counsel with Steve this morning, you know, and Steve and I spoke about a number of things, and you know, it's to be occupying this position, to occupy until the return. You know, we are going to be marginalized, vilified, and Steve, you were ahead of the curve on this so long ago, decades ago, and to see this day finally arrive, my goodness. Wow, you know, it's just...
We had a caller last night, I think it was Lars, who said that his pastor addressed the same-sex marriage issue and said that if every Christian was as upset about their own sin in their own life as they were about the same-sex marriage, that we would be in a different place. And that's kind of stuck with me. But I think that people need to understand that we're getting down to a time where talk is not going to matter. It's going to be our actions. And it's going to have to be actions in obedience, of obedience. You know, we can talk the talk, but will we walk the walk? That's the question we need to ask ourselves.
Well, I'd like to address that whole concept because I'm going to tell you something. I disagree with that. I don't disagree that we all have to have personal repentance and personal walks with Jesus, but what he's doing, and I'm sorry, and Joe, please, I'm not picking on you, okay? He does not understand the nature of the battle. The battle is obviously each one of us must come to the Father through Jesus' Son. Each one of us must be washed in the blood. But when you're talking about a world that's dying and going into hell and making war with the express purpose of exterminating every single Christian on the planet, that makes it about us. The difference about, and I hope this is clear, there is a difference in making it about us and our personal sin and making it about God and his demands on a planet that is in total rebellion. Now, that's a great statement for a sermon on getting right with Jesus and taking the log out of your own eye before trying to take it out of someone else's. But see, that is a missing the bigger picture point. Do you understand what I'm saying, David? I just want to make sure I'm being clear.
I understand exactly. You know, this is that was a kind of a deflection. You know,
right.
We all ought to be concerned about our personal sin. But this is affecting us in such a way.
This is what destroys nations. This is, David, why I'm frustrated, okay? And listen, I know the attack set, and I thank God. I want to take this minute, too, to thank everyone who prays for you and prays for me and prays for Doug.
Absolutely.
And prays for Joe and financially supports it. Those of you that send your tithes, you know, and I'm not asking for anything, but thank you for keeping Doug on the air. Because do you really want to pay the mortgage on a $40 million building? Or do you really want to put fuel in a Gulfstream 5 or whatever, you know, at $65 million? The point is this. There's too much deflection. Here's what I want to make a clear statement. And this is what I, and God, please help me here. We are talking about the God of all heaven, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, in his fury, roaring like a lion to absolutely judge the nations. Woe unto those nations that forget God. When, David, you and I came on this show, and I'm putting into perspective, okay, in essence, we built a monument, and I'm saying this, unto the Lord to stand against the slaughter that's being planned. No one 4 years ago accepted the fact that the United States government was going to go to war against Christians. No one accepted the fact that the government was going to kill veterans by denying them health care, by prolonging, if you will, or blocking their access to medicine and doing everything else, in some cases literally terminating them. No one wants to deal with this statement. When Jesus said, just as in the days of Noah, so would it be in the coming of the Son of Man, and we're there, and the rainbow is being mocked, every single thing that God has done is being ridiculed, mocked, and scorned. So tonight it's not about our personal sin. Yeah, we need to repent. And you and I did, weeks of that. You and I called upon God. We prayed the prayers of Daniel. We prayed the prayers of personal repentance. And it still hasn't dawned on people that the United States is going to make war on the Christians. Those FEMA camps are for the Christians. The gun owners get blasted. But David, that's what I'm trying to say. Doug, that's what I'm trying to say. And Joe, that's what I'm specifically saying. There is a bigger context that we're talking about tonight. Oh, God, help me in Jesus' name. The bigger context is that unless we stand up in the power of his might, unless we apply the blood of Jesus to the doorpost, just like in the book of Exodus, and the angel of death passes over, this is what you're up against. Your children and multi-generational murder. When I was praying about abortion, the Lord said, Steve, it's not just one generation. It's their children's children that were aborted. I never thought about that until basically Aaron's statement on four generations. God has born, if you will. He has prophesied. You can go to every prophecy on the end times from the early 1900s, and they all have the common theme, America is going to be judged, America is going to be destroyed. The mockers, the scoffers, the ridiculers, the scorners, the deniers, the haters. It's hate Jesus Christ, end of story. That's what they're doing. That's what they're wanting, and that's what they're succeeding at. And the problem is the mega churches and the denialists, okay, are affording them the luxury of slaughter. You don't know, ladies and gentlemen, that the mega pastors and even good-sized church pastors haven't already cut deals. And here's how it'll go. We'll let you keep your house. We'll let you keep your stuff. We just want the name of all the troublemakers in your church, and we want your help. We tell them all they have to go to camps. You know, it's like this. It's like every single slaughter in history means nothing. The Armenian slaughter of the Christians. Prophets rose up, warned and warned and warned, and the Armenians, the ones that fled, and this isn't talking about fleeing the United States. If God tells you to flee, flee. If God tells you to stay, stay. But the point is, Jesus is a good shepherd. The sheep hear his voice. And you've got to understand, ladies and gentlemen, you're in the crosshairs. And what David just shared about Rick, the bottom line is people want us dead. I want to read something really quick, and then where are we at? We're just, and then we'll turn it over in the next hour and go wherever you want to go. But here's what my friend the Navy SEAL said. He said, listen to these men. The swords of our enemies are being unsheathed. There is a legion of demons on their way here at a high rate of speed right now. Their scouts and point men already are here. Repent and put on the armor of God now. But understand what we're going to fight against. You don't put on armor unless you're going to fight, okay? You don't grab a sword unless you intend to use it. 99% of the people do not understand that a sword is part of Ephesians 6, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, but in essence, you're going to stand facing the enemy. And now, David, we used to basically see, you as a pastor, me as whatever I do for the last 40 years, basically, we've already been in it for a while. And when I say W-H-I-L-E, so we've had to deal with the wiles of the enemy. There's coming a time when we're going to be overwhelmed, and the only way that we're going to make it across the Jordan River, the only way we're going to make it through the Red Sea, is for God to rise up and scatter our enemies. And I categorically reject the limp-wristed Mickey Mouse avoidance of the issue. This is what the Destroyer is out to do. He is going to provoke the Holy God, the Holy One of Heaven, and he knows what turns God's stomach and causes God to move. The prophecy that he gave you, David, the prophecy that he gave, or the blueprint that he gave Aaron, these things are all testifying. It's not on the way. And to all of you, maybe what we better take on in the next hour is that if people understand that this is as late as we are telling you, and if Jade Helm goes live or whatever goes live in September 15th or September of 2016, that should be the countdown to say, God, you've given me a warning. You've given me the battle plan of the enemy. Surely Lord God will do nothing except he reveals his secrets to his servants the word. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Listen, you just heard on Monday Aaron Brickman share the word of heaven. You heard tonight David share the prophecy God gave him in 2012. We're pleading for men's souls. Again, it's no longer choose ye this day who you will follow, but choose ye this night. I'm going to read a poem from Randy Conway. Then, David, after I read it, I'll turn it over to you, because the thing that is astonishing to me is that we're in the time period where everything prophesied by the prophets and by Jesus are unfolding before our eyes. And I now understand why Jesus said, having eyes to see, they see not. Having ears to hear, they hear not, because our hearts are darkened. This is Randy Conway just sent me this, and I love his poems because they're dead on. Dead on the 4th of July. We all remember a movie called Born on the 4th of July, but I think this is one of, Randy, God bless you, this is one of your most prophetic. Do you remember when the 4th of July was a day of celebration? That was before we abandoned God, and we have abandoned him as a nation. It used to be a day commemorating the independence we declared, but now the blood-bought freedoms we have known by lies have been ensnared. Now the 4th of July is for me a day of remembering what we have lost. Is there hope for our nation to be restored now that the Rubicon has been crossed? Benjamin Franklin stated we have a republic and questioned if we could keep it. The truth be told, we have lost the republic if we are honest enough to admit it. It is righteousness that exalts the nation, but sin of the people is a reproach. Our sin remains sin, even when hidden behind the Supreme Court's black cloaks. When the wicked cometh, then cometh also contempt. And now the 4th of July has become a day for Christians to lament. And it has become a day of memorial, remembering the nation that has died. The land of the free, the home of the brave, has become the home of lies. Isaiah says of those who reject God, and thorns shall come up in her palaces. And as we listen and follow the noise of the demons, as through the perverse they howl, we shall as a nation become a habitation of dragons and a court for owls. A double meaning there. Now, this is interesting. What will the pulpits proclaim on Sunday when they speak of the 4th of July? Will they cling to the political correctness and the putrid rainbow lies? Or will they tend the flock and feed the sheep, preaching Jesus crucified? And our resurrection as a nation depends on repentance and being purified. The fireworks no longer will commemorate the bombs bursting in the air. They will remind us that America surrendered with a shot because we didn't care. The living God waits on us to humble ourselves and turn to him and pray. We must repent for both great and small, for we are approaching God's judgment day. You know, the bottom line is, David, that covers a lot. But if you would, go wherever you sense the Spirit of God is leading, because here's where we're at now. All these things have come upon us like ancient Israel of old, a people that were blessed beyond any other nation in the history of the world up until that time, then America, the land of the covenant. And I don't think people understand that only pretty much two nations, and I'm talking about the greater nation of Israel, not what you currently see. I'm not knocking that, but the real nation of Israel was much bigger than all of the people even know the historic boundaries. Or the land of America, when the Puritans and Pilgrims, mocked by Hollywood they have been, The bottom line is they cut a covenant with God who freed them from sin. So go ahead, David. Go wherever the Lord leads you, because we're in the last hour, and who knows what happens on the 4th, because this is the hour. This is the hour of darkness that's coming upon the land. Go ahead, sir.
I want to read tonight from the Citizens' Rule Book. A Palladium of Liberty was given to me from Senator Helms when I first met Senator Helms back in 1985, which would have been 30 years ago. And he handed me the little book, and he said, I want you to read this and study this. And I've kept it now for over 30 years, but I want to read two short pages, one from Patrick Henry and the other from Jefferson. Give me liberty or give me death. Patrick Henry shot. Young Christian attorney Patrick Henry saw why a jury of peers is so vital to freedom. It was March 1775 when he rode into the small town of Culpeper, Virginia. He was totally shocked by what he saw. There, in the middle of the town square, was a minister tied to a whipping post, his back laid bare and bloody with the bones of his ribs showing. He had been scourged mercilessly, like Jesus, with whips laced with metal. Patrick Henry is quoted as saying, when they stopped beating him, I could see the bones of his rib cage. I turned to someone and asked what the man had done to deserve such a beating as this. The reply given him was that the man being scourged was a minister who refused to take a license. He was one of 12 who were locked in jail because they refused to take a license. A license often becomes an arbitrary control by government that makes a crime out of what ordinarily would be not a crime. It turns a right into a privilege. 3 days later, they scourged him to death. This was the incident which sparked Christian attorney Patrick Henry to write the famous words which later became the rallying cry of the Revolution. What is it that Gentile men wish? What would they have? Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of change and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. Later he made this part of his famous speech at St. John's Episcopal Church in Williamsburg, Virginia. Now I want to read from Thomas Jefferson. In 1789, Thomas Jefferson warned that the judiciary, if given too much power, might ruin our republic and destroy our rights. The new Constitution has secured these individual rights in the executive and legislative departments, but not in the judiciary. It should have established trials by the people themselves, that is to say, by jury, emphasis added. The judiciary of the United States is the subtle corpse of sappers and miners constantly working underground to undermine the foundations of our confederated fabric. The federal judiciary, an irresponsible body, working like gravity by night and by day, gaining a little today and a little tomorrow, and advancing its noiseless step like a thief over the field of jurisdiction until all shall be usurped from the states and the government of all be consolidated into one. When all government, in little as in great things, shall be drawn to Washington as the center of all power, it will render powerless the checks provided of one government on another and will become as venal and oppressive as the government from which we separated. The opinion which gives to the judges the right to decide what laws are constitutional and what not, not only for themselves and their own sphere of action, but for the legislative and executive also in their spheres, would make the judiciary a despotic branch. Judges should be withdrawn from the bench whose erroneous bias are leading us into dissolution. It may indeed injure them in fame or fortune, but it saves the republic. He wrote that in 1789. He understood. These men understood tyranny. And we have sat here as Christians. That was what invoked Patrick Henry's famous statement, give me liberty or give me death. And this is where it's coming, folks. This is where it's coming. And this is why the church is God's. It's not man's. It's not the state's. It's not the legislative body in Congress. It's not the Supreme Court justices. It's God's church, which he purchased with his own blood. But these men understood that the government would become so oppressive, it wants to become God. God is theocratic, theocracy. God reigns, God rules. And that's why Daniel said in his prayer in Daniel 9, our judges have brought this judgment upon us. We've taken prayer out of the school. I remember in 1963 when the principal came over the intercom and said the president of the United States has been assassinated. And I remember my third grade school teacher got the Bible, read scriptures, and said, let's pray. She wouldn't have a job if she did that today. This nation has become a godless, God-hating, and God-hateful nation. And these preachers, all of them, all these women, usurping authority, usurping power, everything I see is taking us down the wrong path. And people say, well, you're a male chauvinist pig. Well, I'm just being honest. There were no women at the Constitution signing. Jesus didn't choose one woman in the 12 apostles, not to say that women don't have their part in the body of Christ. But the husband is to be the head of his household. And how is it then when two men get married, I want to know who the wife is. I want to know who the husband is. I want to know, do they say, you may now kiss the bride. Which one's the bride? Your people say, well, this, you know, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. This is why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. This is why he rained hellfire and brimstone. That's how much God loathed it. People say, well, you know, I've heard the Princeton and the Yale, the Harvard theologians say, I've heard them say it. Well, we don't really know what the sin was. Well, that's a reprobate to make a statement of that nature. And here's what Peter said in 2 Peter 2:6. And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that afterwards should live ungodly. Peter in the New Testament says, this is what God does to those who live like Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, that tells you we're headed for some kind of a fiery holocaust in this nation. This nation is going to be judged for its sin. And I know everyone listening to me knows preachers do not preach against sin anymore. And sin is the culprit. Sin is what destroys. It maims. It mutilates. It kills. And nobody wants to talk about it, and nobody wants, like the preachers today, don't even want to address any kind of sin in any way, shape, form, or fashion. Just don't mention it. You just ignore it like it don't exist. This is why we're where we are. When I was a child, if all the parents in 1963, whenever, Madeline, got the prayer out of school. If all of the parents would have said, I am not sending my child back to school till you reinstate it, would they have been able to put all the parents in jail? No. But nobody said anything. Nobody did anything. They just let it go. And I'm sure, I don't know the legality there, but I would surmise that it was the Supreme Court justices that allowed that to happen. Steve, you or Doug may know more about that. Joe may know. I don't know. But this is what happens when people sit by and say, well, they won again and we lost. We're losing because we're not standing for Jesus. When God arises, the enemy will be scattered. We're not pleading for God to arise. We're pushing God out. We're pushing God out. You know, we've got to be a witness. We've got to be a light. And we can't hide and we can't run. We've got to stand up, and that means persecution. And I know many listening tonight are full of fear and anxiety and trepidation, but you got to remember, the real battle is the Lord's. He's the one that will fight for us. If we will stand for him, he will fight for us. He knows how to win every battle. There's not one battle he cannot win. And other than Franklin Graham and a few other preachers of smaller stature have said anything publicly, have said one word publicly about what's taking place. Why? Because it's not popular, and we don't want to start a ruckus. And I'm sitting here watching this, and I'm saying, God, please, please smite the hearts of these men that have these vast platforms and have the money. I mean, my God, if you can buy a $65 million jet aircraft, you can run television ads and radio ads that this is a sin. This is an abomination. This is taking us to hell. Even Judge Scalia said, this is the destruction of democracy. But it's like nobody cares. As long as I got my cell phone and my six-pack, I'm in good shape. You know, and that's not what it's about. You know, I haven't seen any news. They haven't watched any television or anything. Haven't had a chance to. Because I want to walk with God. I know something is coming, and I know it's going to be horrible. We were all just awestruck at 9/11, and the churches, man, the churches filled up. Even our ministry doubled the following next 6 months, and after 6 months, it was right back down to where it was before. It didn't last. We had the greatest opportunity to have a revival in this nation, and we squandered it, and those reprobates stood up on the White House steps or the Congressional House steps and saying, God bless America. I am so sick and tired of hearing people say, God bless America. When is America going to bless God? When is America going to thank God? He is the one that gives us all of our rights, all of our privileges, all of our freedoms. Not men, but man has brainwashed us into believing, well, you got to listen to Romans 13 and you got to submit. Listen, abortion is legal, but am I going to do it? Absolutely not. It's a sin. It's murder. And this is what they're going to do. They're brainwashing the people, deceiving the people that you're going to have to submit. This is God's will. When it's contrary to the word of God, that's why the disciples said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Peter, James, and John said, we are not going to do this. And they suffered. They suffered. They told them, don't you preach anymore. As soon as they got out of jail, they was right back on the streets preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the power of the Holy Ghost. You don't hear any preachers today preaching from the book of Acts. That's why it's called Acts of the Apostles. It is a litany of things that God was doing and how the church was growing and how God was saving and how God was baptizing and people were being touched all over the whole world, the missionary trips that Paul took, etc. But you won't hear preachers preach on Acts because they don't even believe. I had somebody email me last week and said tongues, the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues, came from Africa. And, I was so upset. Man, the man told me, I sinned every day. I personally sinned every day. Well, what he doesn't know, he blasphemed the Holy Ghost because the Holy Ghost came from heaven. Luke wrote, there came a sound from heaven, not Africa. It didn't come from Africa. It came from Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I will send you another comforter. And then this guy tells me he's saved, and I'm the one that's lost, and I have demons in me that speaks in tongues. What blasphemy. And this is a so-called Christian. This man claims he's a Christian. But Jesus said, I will pray the Father, and he'll give you another comforter. and he will abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, and he dwelleth with you, and he shall be in you. And I will come unto you. I will not leave you comfortless. Jesus comes to us through the Holy Ghost. And all of this type of preaching is gone. This is what Steve and I cut our teeth on when we were coming into this thing. And that's all gone now. That's all gone. And you wonder why we're in the shape we're in. And I talk to professional people. Steve and I have a mutual friend that's a doctor. I got a mutual friend that's a dentist. I have a banker friend whose kids, their kids are in college. And they say, man, my kids are coming home, and they're accepting this stuff. They're accepting the homosexuality. Well, Dad, everybody has a right to love somebody. That's true. But not unnatural love, not unnatural affection. Paul said there'd be a loss of natural affection. Natural affection is a man loving a woman. That's the way God made it. Animals, male and female, they mate so they can reproduce. And watch that little dog when that mama has those pups and that male is around. Buddy, she'll attack him if he gets too close to her pups. Because that's her nature. She's a mother. She's going to protect. And they're telling me this is normal for two men or two women to embrace this lifestyle. And the Bible is old and out of date and got to be done away with. That's what they want. They want us to do away with the Word of God. But we can't. But that's what's happening to us because preachers are failing to stand up and be accounted. I remember years ago being discouraged with the ministry, depressed with the ministry, and the Lord spoke to my heart and said, all I ever ask you to do is preach my word. If you preach my word, you have honored me and you've been faithful. That's all you have to do. I take care of the saving. I take care of the deliverance. I take care of the healing. Whatever it is, God does that. I don't. But I must preach the word. And regretfully, there is a famine of the word, and as I said earlier in the program, it's all about money today. Write me, and I'll send you a prophecy. Snake oil, snake water. I mean, it's unbelievable. And what's so bad is how the people fall for it. I mean, how the people fall for it. That's what gets me. I mean, forget God. Where's your common sense? Where's your common sense in these issues? It's like it's all gone. You know, I prayed today. You know, James said, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives liberally unto all men. I say, God, give me wisdom. I can't deal with the issues of this life because the world is so cunning. The world is so crafty. You know, they live by one set of rules, and we the lemmings, the lay people, live by another set of rules. I got a friend got in severe trouble. He's a businessman because he lied to a federal officer. And they fined him and penalized him nearly $200,000. He said, ain't that funny? Lois Lerner can lie, lose her emails. The president can lie. Y'all live by different standards. I tell a lie, and look what you do to me. Look what you do to me. There's something, it's delusion. It's a spirit of delusion that's come on this generation. And it's like they can't see. And Jesus said, they have eyes to see, they see not, ears to hear, and they hear not. So we're witnessing the word of God as it's coming to pass. And all I can say tonight in closing is stay in the presence of God and stay in the word of God. Those are the two keys to your strength. No man is as strong as when he stands in the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said, having done all to stand therefore. Don't waver, don't oscillate, don't vacillate, stand. The storm, I'm telling you, Matthew 7, the storm is going to be so ferocious. If you've built on the sand, you're going to be washed away. You're going to sink. If you built on the rock, which is Jesus Christ, when the storm passes, you're still going to be standing. And these people, all of these people who think that they're in power, are going to find out they had no power. Jesus told Pilate, you have no power except it were given to you from above. The people that are in authority, just like Mitch McConnell having some kind of orgasmic emotional feeling, out-of-body experience on this trade bill, what kind of a man is that? Finally got control of the Senate and talks like that, out-of-body experience on legislation. What? Those are seducing spirits, folks. These men are seduced by hell itself. And they stand up there and want to act like they're sane. There's not a sane man up there, I hardly believe anymore, anywhere, because the spirit of delusion. And God said in Isaiah 64, he said, I will choose your delusions. Now, that's a scary thought when God says, I'm going to choose the delusion that I'm going to put on you. And in the New Testament, 2 Thessalonians 2:11, 12, for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. And so the delusions are here, and they think they're all right. I mean, they really do. Isaiah 66 and 4, I will choose their delusions and bring their fears upon them, because when I called, none did answer. When I spake, they did not hear, but they did evil before mine eyes and choose that in which I delighted not. So I don't know the choice of God's delusions that he's going to send on these people, the devices or whatever, but you can rest assured that God is not a man that he should lie. And he said, I'm going to bring their fears upon them. You see, you may not understand this tonight, but they have their fears too. They have fear and anxiety and trepidation too. They may feign and pretend that they're in control and they don't, but they have fear because there is a God in heaven and the earth is his footstool, and they have their own anxiety, but they think through their power and their own might they're going to somehow succeed, but they're not. They're coming down because the earth is his footstool. You think about that statement. God props his feet upon the earth. It's a pretty big God if you ask me. Steve, I'm going to give it back to you, sir.
Well, David, as you were sharing the heart of the Lord, I've been sensing incredible opposition. I've been asking the Lord to show me the spirit behind things and not just the things, okay? I'm going to go to Matthew 25 in a minute. But I had sent an email to Romy, and she's an intercessor, and I said, please pray that I will know what to say in the last hour of the show. I sense great opposition. Then she's emailed me back, and the Lord gave me Matthew 25. Steve, there is great opposition to this program, and to you and Pastor David speaking up and loudly for righteousness through our Lord God. Much of it is coming from the dead church who listens and aren't aware that they are not even saved. They have a form of godliness, but deny the power and authority of a living God. The remnant is going to shine like the noonday sun, and they shall arise in the midst of persecution. Then she said this, I'm praying for the Lord to fill your heart and mouth to cry out for the lost that belong to him and pull them out of the evil one's talons. Then, it's interesting, I get another email from an intercessor, and she's, I guess she's in church or something, but this is what she got. These came in within minutes of each other, neither one knowing. I was just thinking about the warnings that you and Pastor Langford are giving out tonight and heard God speak. They don't believe me. Now, I want to make that clear. God's saying, they don't believe me. Now, that's a mouth of two or three witnesses. What I'm learning, David, and we're seeing it in Aaron Brickman on Monday, you on Wednesday, the 1-2. And here's the thing I think I better remind everybody. I don't know what this means, okay? It was not given to me to understand the statement that was told to me. But the Lord said, I'm going to move swiftly and quickly in judgment. And he did. He said, David will be the second witness. and I have pled my case to the nations. Now comes the hand of my judgment upon the nations. I'm telling you what, I mean, that causes me to tremble, David. I know the living God. And, you know, you brought up the book of Acts. Here's what those who profess to be believers, I wrote this down. I think, Randy, God bless you, you have an effect on me. They want snacks, but not the power of the Holy Ghost as manifest in the book of Acts. They want little tidbits, okay? They want something to chew on, but they never want to go forth. And I want to make it clear, you made a powerful statement. I want to echo it. Those of you that do not understand the gifts of the Spirit, those of you that have never experienced the power from on high, the book of Acts is filled, Acts chapter 2, 10 and 19, where the Spirit of God, these are all saved people, but they did not have the power. They did not have the baptism. They did not have the power that Jesus told them to and commanded them to go and wait for it to be poured out. They were saved. Jesus in John 20:22 breathed into them and said, "Receive the Spirit," or, you know, "Receive you the Spirit of God." But they didn't have the power. Now, the key to all this is, and I'm going to say this, when you get hit with the fact that you've blasphemed the Holy Spirit, new Christians especially, you haven't. But the man that made that statement to David Langford, I want to tell you, I hope you're listening, you'd better be careful. And I put the fear of God into you to have a literal encounter with the fear of God. This is not a curse. When you attribute to the spirit of holiness, the spirit of the living God, and call that the work of the devil, you're treacherously and dangerously close to blaspheming the Holy Ghost. The Word of God states that all manner of all evil spoken against God, the Father will be forgiven, and Jesus. God will forgive everything, but he won't forgive that. He will not allow his Holy Spirit or the beauty of his holiness to be ascribed to the devil. There's a difference, I know, when people do it in ignorance, but there's also a difference when people who know better do it. I actually said that on a program, David, and I had one guy from Lucifer's Legion send me an email blaspheming the Holy Spirit, and he said, "I want you to know I'm going to hell, and I expect to go to hell, and I want to go to hell." Well, I just said, "Be it unto you according to your faith." Matthew 25. "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them." I want everyone to ask the question, why would they have a lamp and no oil? "But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, 'Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him.' Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, 'Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy it for yourselves.'" I think a modern version of that would be, go watch the television that never gave you the oil in the first place. "And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterwards also came the other virgin, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open unto us.' But he answered, 'The Lord answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh.'" They had the perception, they were probably virgins. They had the lamps, so it looked like, it's probably like someone who goes into church with a Bible, never opens this or reads it. But the point is that they were foolish. They never expected the word of the Lord to be fulfilled. They never really expected the bridegroom to show up. The oil is a type of the Holy Spirit. But I know, David, that you've preached on the 10 virgins, but let me share this. I mean, virtue is a very rare thing in the world today, but in the scripture, Matthew 25, starting at the first verse, there is a big thing. You can look like a lamp. You can tell everybody you got the lamp. You can brag about your virtue. But when the bridegroom comes, do you have oil in your lamp? Do you have oil in your lamp? And that's what we struggle with. A lot of people haven't realized it yet, but they will come up against odds. They will come up against incidents. You have, David, I have, where it's bigger than we are. Doug, where it's bigger than you are. Joe, where it's definitely bigger than you are. I only say that because everything is at war against us. And the only thing that will take us through is the power of his might. Having a form of godliness and denying the power thereof, anybody that was, and I told David when he told me about that email, I said, David, I'm not a pastor, and I had to control my tongue, and I'm praying that that happens more frequently. But that is the epitome of self-righteous deception and blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. So, David, when you preach on Matthew 25, we've heard every form of spiritualization on Matthew 25. The bottom line is, these were virgins, they had lamps, they looked like the lamps would work, but there was nothing in the lamps. Go ahead and take it.
Well, here's the key. And they that were ready, not those that were getting ready, not those that were presumptuous and thought they were ready, but it is emphatic, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. I want you to notice tonight, five were wise and five were foolish. Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. That's a type of wheat and tares in Matthew 25. And the wheat and tares is in Matthew 13. They look alike. They sounded alike. They all had the same aspiration to go and meet the bridegroom. But here was the key. Nobody knew when the bridegroom would come. So the five wives took their lamps and took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But the foolish just took their lamps. So when the oil that was in the lamp ran out, they were out. And so the Greek says, they said, our lamps are going out. But the Greek says, our lamps are going out. And they said, give us of your oil. And the wise said, not so. Not so. Lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. Now to me, that brings in the mark of the beast. Revelation 13:16, and he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell, save he had the mark or the name or the number of the beast. The ones that were prepared, the wise, didn't have to buy and sell. They were already prepared. The foolish were the ones that had to go and buy and sell. And this is why Jesus, I believe, uses that analogy. It's not happenstance. When he's relating to his second coming, he talks about buying and selling oil. In Revelation 16, that's one of the charges to the judgments. Do not hurt the oil and the wine. Don't harm those. The Steve Wells said it's a type. Preached in many ways, but it's a type of the Spirit. You all need the Spirit of God, and I don't want to demean or berate or belittle my Baptist brothers and sisters, but you get the Spirit when you get saved, but you don't get the baptism in the Holy Ghost, because the baptism in the Holy Ghost had not yet been given. So how can anybody get something that's not yet been given? In John 7:38, Jesus said, he that believeth in me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. And so John the Baptist preached the baptism in the Holy Ghost. He said, I have baptized you with water unto repentance. Here it is. Who's coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoe latchet I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. A total distinct difference. And what Steve said, that preachers don't preach on the book of Acts. Because let me tell you something about the Holy Ghost. He deals with you all the time. He deals with you all the time. If you have the Holy Spirit of God, he deals with you about everything in your life. I mean everything. I was just a child, and I was the luckiest guy in the world. about the speckle ball machine. Some of you listening to me remember the old speckle ball machine. You put a penny in the machine, you get that speckle ball, it was worth a nickel. And I could buy me a whole Reese cup for that when I was a kid. I got the baptism in the Holy Ghost when I was 12 years old. Monday after I got home from school, I went across the street to the store and I got my money out and I'd shake that little bubblegum machine. And I'd get ready to put my money in. That day, the Holy Spirit checked my heart, said, don't do that no more. That's gambling. Now, I'm just 12 years old. I'm just a kid. But he said, that's and it was. I was putting in money, taking a gamble to get more. I never played the speckle ball machine again the rest of my life. And he said, well, you wouldn't have went to hell. No, I wouldn't have went to hell. But you see, the Holy Ghost teaches us and corrects us and reproves us and rebukes us. And the greatest thing of all is the power that he gives us. You know, I get so many emails, people talking about the authority, that I preach with authority, I speak with authority. It's not me, it's the Holy Ghost, it's the Spirit of God. I don't have any authority. I'm just a man like any of us, but it's the Spirit of God and the Word of God that is the authority. That's like true law. A true police officer has authority. When he says, put your hands around behind your back, it's like my police officer friends tell me, when they decide to arrest a man, they're going to arrest him. There may be a fight. There may be a struggle. There may be tased, billy club, whatever. Once that officer decides to arrest you, he's not going to change his mind. Well, when he says put your hands behind your back, you better put your hands behind your back, because if you don't, there's going to be a confrontation. When the Holy Ghost deals with you, do what he says to do, because if you miss God, you're going to miss not only your blessing, but somebody else's blessing. The word that God gave Aaron Brickman, the words through the years that God has given Steve or myself or Dimitri Dudeman, these are blessings to the body of Christ. And we have to be obedient in giving what the Lord says. Let me quote it again. Ezekiel 3:17, Son of Man, I have made thee therefore a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the words at my mouth and give them warning from me. We're just telling you what God is saying. That's why I'm a Bible preacher. I know I don't err when I preach the Word, because I believe in the inerrancy of the Word of God. I believe the Word of God is true, holy, and pure, and undefiled, and immutable. So if I stay in the Word, I've not erred, because 1 John chapter 4, verse 6 tells us plainly, there are two spirits that are at work all the time in the earth. And one is the spirit of truth, and one is the spirit of error. 1 John 4:6, we are of God. Me, Steve, Joe, Doug, we are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. If you're in the Word and the Spirit of God is dwelling in you, you know when you hear error. Why? Because the spirit of truth tells you that's error. If I was on here tonight, and I'm trying to argue with the listeners, 2 and 2 makes 5, you're all going to say, that guy's an idiot. What does he think? We're stupid? Why would you say I was stupid for trying to convince you of that? Because you know the truth. 2 and 2 makes 4. You know the truth. So you'd say, that guy's not going to trick me. I know that 2 and 2 is 4. Even though I may bring out some great algorithm to try to convince you, et cetera, et cetera. No, you know the truth. Well, Jesus said in John 16:13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. There are those of you listening, you get a clear clarion witness. Something's coming, and I need to get ready. And some of you are saying, I've heard this rhetoric before. Nothing's going to happen. 2 months before 9/11, I taught on what I call the fall events. People thought I was stupid. You remember, Steve, when I first came out with this in 1998? I got emails, letters saying I was a buffoon, I was stupid. So you think judgment will happen in the fall of the year? And then I've even had people say, well, the fall was not till September the 23rd, and it took place on September 11th, so you missed it. That shows you how they'll strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. Now, the last event happened September the 28th, so we were in the fall of the year. But in the Hebrew calendar, every 2.7 years, you have to add a leap month, and it's called the Adar, and it falls between Adar, the last month, and Nisan, the first month. Nisan, Exodus chapter 12, he said, this will be the beginning of months for you when they came out of Egypt. But for a lunar calendar, they have to add this leap month. So if it's September the 11th on God's calendar, it could have been October the 11th. I don't watch it that closely to keep up with the cycles. But that just shows you how nitpick people are. But I know what God showed me in Revelation 19:14, the fruits which thy soul hath lusted after are departed from thee. And the word fruits there is used like it is nowhere else in the entire Bible. It's evening tide at the close of the day at the end of summer. And then when you put that with Jeremiah 8:20, the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we're not saved. And Nebuchadnezzar came in there and seized Jerusalem in the fall of the year. And King Darius the Medo-Persian came in the fall of the year, October the 12th, 539 B.C., and the handwriting on the wall, and Belshazzar was killed that night. And I was doing some study 2 weeks ago, and Steve, they set up martial law for 2 weeks. History records they set up martial law for 2 weeks until King Darius came in himself into the city of Babylon and reorganized the government. But until he did that, they were under martial law for 2 weeks. I didn't know that until just a few weeks ago when I was doing some more historical study on that event.
David, yeah, share how that was made real to you, because most people say, martial law is not in the Old Testament. Where are you going, Langford? You know, I know you shared it with me, but just share the word, what it means.
Well,
that was amazing. I never knew that.
Yeah, what it was, you know, they were having their drunken party. Daniel chapter 5, the handwriting of God appears on the wall, meeny, meeny, tickle you farson. And what Darius did was they dug a trench and diverted the Euphrates River because it came through Babylon, and they thought they were impervious. And they were to some degree. But see, God put it in the king's hearts to fulfill his will. And so they diverted the water, and they came under what's called the sluice gate. They came up under the river into the city, and they really took over without much fanfare, you know. There just wasn't much to it. And in the process, they shut everything down and declared martial law. And after they got everybody, quote-unquote, arrested, quarantined, whatever they were, King Darius, 2 weeks later, he comes into the city. He sets up the Medo-Persian Empire. And, of course, Daniel received exceeding favor. He was in exile. He was there. He's in the captivity. He stayed there. He didn't leave. My point is, they did declare martial law and took over the whole place. And so when people say, oh, that's not going to happen, martial law is hundreds and hundreds of years old. And that's what they do when they come in and take over, because they're going to get it like they want it. This is all the type of preparation that we're witnessing in the United States right now to declare such an event and take over. We're still under the executive order, an emergency act since September the 11th, 2001. We're under some, Steve, what is it? We're under some executive order relative to an act of emergency. They've kept us in this frame since then. That's been 14 years ago.
Yeah, a state of national emergency.
That's it. And that's where we are. And people don't even realize it. So at the drop of a hat, they could declare martial law and say, we're changing everything from the currency, Internet. It can all change just that quickly. So martial law is nothing new. It's as old as it can be. But that's what they do when they come in and take over, till they reorganize and get it set up like they want it. And that's the road we're headed down, folks. So I just want you to know that, as Solomon said, there's nothing new under the sun. And God punished Babylon exceedingly for their treatment to Israel, and he did it through the Medo-Persian Empire, and I believe we're fighting the Medo-Persians now with Iran, ISIS, all of these fragmented, the Sunnis, the Shiites, all of this. This is all Islam, Medo-Persian Empire, and in Jeremiah 51, God said he would stir up the spirit of the kings of the Medes. It's God who is stirring this up. He's letting it come to pass. And that's why I said tonight, you know, in closing, people need to get in the secret place. Jeremiah 51:11, make bright the arrows, gather the shields. The Lord hath raised up the spirit of the kings of the Medes, for his device is against Babylon to destroy it, because it is the vengeance of the Lord, the vengeance of his temple. And I don't think that means the earthly temple, but the judgment that comes out of the temple in Revelation chapter 11, verse 19. That's where the lightning and the thundering and the hail that comes out of the holy temple of God in heaven, which he showed Moses how to build and construct the pattern. And so it's God's vengeance, and that's where the vengeance is vented from, the temple which is in heaven, the wrath of God. Because when the Holy of Holies, that's where the glory would come down, and if the men were not right with God, you all know it would kill them. And I just pray tonight that people's hearts have been awakened, eyes have been opened, ears have been opened, and you understand that what our government from the Supreme Court justices have done to us is invoked God's wrath and God's judgment on this nation. That's what they've done to us.
If I can interject something, Pastor, very quickly here.
Sure, you go right ahead. I'm done.
You know what, Pastor? You had mentioned Madeleine Murray O'Hare, the 1963 Supreme Court ruling that she promulgated, that she was behind. And I don't know how many people realize this. That was in June of 1963. 9 months later. Listen to this. It was April of 1964. The United States suffered the worst earthquake and tidal wave in recorded history, with a 9.2 earthquake, reduced down to a 9, actually, that went from Alaska to all across the Pacific coastline. It obliterated towns all across Alaska, southward, right down to Los Angeles. Now, in biblical, I was doing a column on this, coincidentally, as related to the current decision. In biblical chronology, that earthquake, it happened on Good Friday of April 1964, occurred at the 11th hour during the 9th hour of Alaskan daylight. So it's very interesting to me. I do believe that, judgment, talk about judgment. There you go.
Yeah, and Daniel 7, verse 10, the judgment is set. I don't know the date, the time, or the place, but you can mark it down. The judgment has been etched in God's stone in the heavenlies, and it will come to pass, just like 9/11, just like the financial debacle. This time, though, we're not prepared. I don't think any of us are really prepared emotionally. We may be spiritually, but I think when we witness the gravity of it, the horror of it, we all will shudder at what God is going to suffer. Russia, I was thinking tonight, Russia is more righteous than we are.
Well, amen.
Yeah. Boy.
I mean, really, they are. They're opposed to sodomy. I read the other week where Iran is making all homosexuals have sex changes. I mean, they are more righteous than us, and we've had more privileges and more rights, and to whom much is given, much is required. And and this will be because of sin. Don't ever wonder why. Then people say, why did God let this happen? Where was God? Remember this, folks, when it happens, put it down tonight. This was because of sin. This was because of sin. Don't blame God. This was because of sin.
Pastor, thank you so very much. Steve, thank you. Any closing words? We got about 60 seconds, Steve.
Joshua 24:14-16. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods or idols which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose ye this day, or in this case, this night, whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were of the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, Joshua speaking, we will serve the Lord. Purpose in your heart, brothers and sisters, you will serve the Lord. And the people answered God and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. God forbid. And I just dug, maybe I got a 30 seconds. There are 12 new perversions that have already been legalized that are going to come to the forefront. And it takes in everything from bestiality, pedophilia, and every other perversion. And I'm telling people, ladies and gentlemen, draw close to Jesus, hold on to him, and just Amen. Tell him how great and mighty he is. Good night, everyone.